Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have a short Q&A. Again, let's bring a, give a warm aloha to Hanalei Sana. So this is your second time working with Kurosawa Kiyoshi, right? Yes. So can you talk about, and then your film that you first worked with him was almost 13, 14 years ago, Bright Future, a very different film from Journey to the Shore. Can you talk about the experiences, the differences between those two films?
Director's style and approach to filmmaking remained the same from 13 or 14 years ago, but the time he spent during that period, I think, had a special meaning to him. He has a wife, and during that period, she suffered a health issue, and it was critical at a certain point. And I think that in their long marriage, when they experienced that moment, I think it brought a certain new kind of love into that relationship. And I think he poured a lot of those emotions into this film. And that experience was something that he didn't have in the previous film. And I think that's where his life kind of really sort of put a lot into this film.
And earlier in the introduction, you talked about how you being in your 40s now, you feel that you're perfect for this role. Can you explain more about that? Is it because of your life experiences or what have you? About this particular character?
でもなんかちょっと経験を経た 人の話っていうのをやりたくて、それでフィリップ・マーラーの話いただいたり、あとはまあ私のところで映画でもそうなんですけど、まあ、ちょっとやっぱり若い時に演じられないような役っていうのをやりたいなと思ったら、ちょうど40代迎えたので、その3本ぐらいが来たので、まあ、この作品はその中の一つで、まあ、僕自身もちょっとまだ離婚の経験とかもあったんで、そういう意味では夫婦の経験があったもんですから、そういう意味では、まあ、今の自分しかできないなって感じはありました。
For those who've actually followed my career, maybe you're aware of the kinds of films that I used to do in the 20s, which were a lot of independent films. Back then in Japan, you had a lot of small theaters, and these were the kind of films that would be screening those. And we were able to do as we like. We had a lot of freedom with those films. But as I entered my 30s, things started to change. Small theaters began to close down. The large theaters remained. There were certain kind of films that needed to be screened those. At those venues, and so you didn't have as many indie films. And I began to, at the same time, grow up a little bit bored with my approach to acting, and so I started wanting to explore new directions, new challenges, and I wanted to, you know, come up with new discoveries. But I also learned about my limitations as well. And as I entered my 40s, I knew that I needed to start thinking about, you know, my new direction in my life and my career, or I'll begin to suffer. So I thought long and hard about, you know, what I wanted to do. And that's when I began to get these offers for very different kinds of roles that I had been thinking about, such as performing A Married Couple, like you just saw, or I did a stage production of Philip Marlowe's Long Goodbye, and, you know, performing a kind of man who has been through life and experienced things. I also was in a film called My Men. And these are all,
yes.
But these were all roles that I couldn't have been able to play when I was a little bit younger. And so these projects all came at the same time. And myself having gone through a divorce in my own life too, I think all these things kind of led to this idea that, you know, there are certain roles I can only do at this stage in my life.
Was that why in your 30s you seeked out, I mean, you pretty much, you worked a lot outside of Japan. We had these collaborations with directors like from Thailand, Panic, Rakan Aram. We worked with Bo Xiao Tian. And was that because you were seeking other challenges?
So it's this one, the three Kaigan and Hito, they are the people. The people who are the people who are the people who are the people who are the people who are現場での何ですかね、こう接し方というか、まあ、俳優に対しての接し方だったり、まあ、それはまあ人と人との接し方だと思うんですけど、そういうものはやっぱり日本人とはちょっと違うんですね。そういうものが結構大きく映画というのは影響する場合もあるんで、そこでやっぱ学んだことっていうのは大きかったですね。やっぱ特に日本の人は僕もそうですけど、コミュニケーションがあんまり得意ではないという部分もあって、どうしてもシャイですから、ただまあ外国の人たちは直接的にそうやって何ですかね、そういう中でやっぱり直接的にそういう役を見つけやすかったっていうのがあったと思うので、それをなんかまあ今だったり、まあそういう30年見つけた後っていうのは生かしていくっていうのもあったと思います。
In kind of meeting a lot of filmmakers from overseas, obviously their approach to filmmaking will often be different. Every filmmaker has a different style about it.But on set, how the directors are relating with the actors are very different from what we see in Japan. And I think that impacts the filmmaking. And in that process, I learned a lot. Japanese people, as you may know, are not as good at communication sometimes, because they tend to be shy. And a lot of foreign directors tend to be a little bit more direct and straightforward in communication. And so it becomes easier for me to find my character in that process. And I think at that stage, I was beginning to learn more about this, and that affected my career.
Let's open up to the audience. If you have any questions regarding Asano-san in this work, in this film, or maybe about his career. Yes.
のところ見てからもう全然演技が
question is, before getting a green card and moving to the U.S., when I was still in Japan, I had a chance to see my man, and I saw it in Full House. But it was a very quiet audience, and I've seen all your films, but I really found when I saw my man that there was a certain range in acting that he reached that I hadn't seen before, and with a recent NHK production, there was a certain hard-boiled quality. Do you see that being a new direction for you?
So it's the whole thing.
一番僕にとっても僕人生にとっても楽しいですし、やってることとっても他にいかせてるような気がするので、これはもう僕の仕事の一つの喜びなので、ぜひぜひ続けたいなと思います。As I just said, what I gain in the 30s, I'm able to really take full advantage of in the film that I kind of do. And I think that's the joy that I find in filmmaking is to take what I've learned in one film and then bring that into what I do in the next one. So that's something I continue to, that I intend to continue to do.
Japanese going outside of Japan to work out overseas, and they come back to Japan as an industry, but there's stigma.
I tend to be a brash type, and I, even if I go overseas, I don't really worry about whether I can come back to Japan and keep working. I just feel confident that I can do that. I think that for some people, they do find difficulty in going overseas and then coming back and finding work. Or for some people, they fear that going overseas, maybe they won't be able to come back and get as many jobs. Or for some people, they worry that maybe working with overseas directors may not be so easy. But I'm the kind of person that actually enjoys and savors the process of feeling that, you know, strange awkwardness as you come back and kind of making things work that way. So it may be different from other actors.
Yes.
The question is that the film deals with reality and non-reality, or the mixture of those two, in a very interesting way. Do you have any thoughts on how that was kind of dealt with, and what the message or what the theme or intention of that?
もしかしたら攻めたかもしれないし、もっと。
For this film in particular, what's more important is not so much my perspective, but that of my wife, played by Ei Fukatsu. And my character simply comes back to apologize, in essence, and is just kind of there as a presence. And I think that from her standpoint, if I were to come back alive, maybe she would have responded differently. Maybe she would have blamed him more. Maybe she would have tried to rely on him more, or grow sweet in some way. Something would have been different, but I think the fact that I'm coming back dead creates a certain distance between the audience and these two characters as you're watching them relate to each other. And I remember my grandmother and how she was able to say certain things only after my grandfather had passed away. And I think in a similar way, maybe only because Yusuke is coming back dead, is the wife able to kind of say and share certain thoughts and emotions with him.
And I've never seen a ghost with a cool orange orange trench coat, which I thought was very cool. But I thought, when we talked about this earlier, how Kiyoshi Kurosawa films beautiful. I haven't seen his films like Cure and Charisma, Tokyo Sonata. He's a very cerebral filmmaker, almost like a very cold director. So to see him make a film that's very romantic in a way, but also with the different costumes and whatnot, I thought was very, very interesting. Any other questions? Yes.
Question is for your, now that you have a career both domestic and overseas, and you also have children of your own, do you have certain dreams for both either your life or your career?
So, this is the whole thing. Come on, one, two, three, get a photo. So, get a kid, you know, it's a good one. Like this, my mom, that's more than I always can have to be a kind of more.
I simply want to continue what I've been doing, and also my children are starting to grow a little bit older, and it seems like they're beginning to find certain things that they want to do with their lives, and hopefully they'll grow old and start earning a lot of money and make things easier for me.
Interesting bit, that your family lineage, you have an American grandfather, and then I think when you were filming a few years ago, we talked about you filming Battleship. You actually went to look for your American roots. Can you talk about that?
So, that's it. Massively, Hawaii Battleship, took the time to look at the Brian's friends. American site, あっという間にその自分のおじいさんの家族の中情報が出てきて、それでもうびっくりして、こんなに簡単に探せんだと思って、でその後でまあ日本に帰ってから、その日本のまあ6年代を作ってくれる会社が、まあ僕のおじいちゃんとドキュメンタリーを作ってくれて、そしたらまあもっと本当に詳しくおじいちゃんがどういうふうに日本にやってきたのか、どういうふうにアメリカに帰ってその後過ごしたかっていうのを調べてくれて、僕の母親もそれをずっと知りたかったんで、まあ
That's correct. While I was in Hawaii filming Battleship, my interpreter at the time, Brian, he had found a website called Ancestry.com, and we punched in my grandfather's name, and suddenly the whole lineage kind of came up. And I was surprised at how easy it was to find information about, you know, your ancestors. And it kind of talked. When I returned to Japan, there was a production company that does documentaries, and they agreed to do a program about my grandfather. And so they went and did a lot of research about how my grandfather had come to Japan initially, how he returned, and I was able to learn a lot about my grandfather that my mother had wanted to know as well. My grandfather has, you know, has been dead, but I was able to, you know, receive a very precious experience about that.
Yes.
The movie Battleship you played 5 years ago, you were Captain Nagata. I was Admiral Hashimoto. Good to see you again. You haven't changed a bit, yeah. My wife and I always make a point to see your movies and stuff. Thank you very much. Yeah.
This gentleman was part of the production of Battleship, where was part of the casting.
Yeah, I was the Admiral Hashimoto.
He played Admiral Hashimoto.
He played Captain Nagato in the Mio.
Captain Nagato, of course. What is Hawaii to you?
What kind of a place is it?
I've been to Honolulu and the island of Oahu several times, but perhaps even more than that, I've been to Maui several times, especially with my family, and I've found it to be a very relaxing place, especially this indescribable breeze, how great it feels. And I would just go there with my family and have a great time. And I would go back to Japan and often remember that experience, and it would make me want to go to the beach again. So it's a very relaxing place for my heart.
Yes, sir. Can you just quickly say the names of the towns or the places that you went in this movie?
Tokyo, of course. Ashikaga, Sagami, and we probably went to Saitama Prefecture as well, but this is all in the Tokyo metropolitan area.
Even
in
the country areas.
Yes, even. Thor was I believe my first American film, and yes, I did audition. We had to do a video audition, and I was cast for the role of Hogan, and I was in part one, part two, and now that, you know, the whole Avengers thing is taken off and it's become very popular, I do expect that there will be a pretty person.
So then, yeah, probably, I guess, the Hogan's 出番 が多いかどうか, American fans' 応援にかかる。ぜひみんなが朝ドラのもっと見せようと言ってくれれば。
And when Thor 3 is finally not. Probably depends on the voices of the fans. If you guys want to see more of Hogan in the films, then maybe you'll get to see more of me. So it's all up to you guys.
But I think also you, I mean, can you talk about your recent film that you just mentioned, Martin Scorsese. How was it working with him, and how, you have to also audition for the role.
It was an interesting experience. I'm not sure how much I can actually share. Maybe you guys can all keep this confidential. But I did audition, and initially I wasn't cast. There was a second audition that I was able to go to, and that time the director was there, and he read with me. So he was kind of reading against me, and I remember he was an intense man who kept on, you know, asking for more and more, more powerful, more intensity from me. And you know, as you know, he was kind of reading with me, I grew less nervous, but I wasn't cast. But I didn't want to give up somehow. And I, you know, the manager told me, sorry, they didn't get the part. I said, I know, I want to keep doing this. And he said, no, you didn't get the part. This is over. I said, no, I don't want to give up. And finally, a different role had come up, and I was up for that. And the manager was surprised that this opportunity came up, but I read through it again, and this time, a wonderful. And I knew that this was the type of director that I really, really wanted to work with somehow. And on set, you know, he proved to be just as intense as I expected him to be, and it was a very precious experience.
Any other questions? And that film, by the way, is called Silence, and it's coming out next year.
Was where he's carrying the older man, like the newspaper delivery man. Suddenly, the character says "Yabai," which means, I'm not sure how it was subtitled.